Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here with us this afternoon. This panel is organized by Idea Center. Idea Center has played an important role in the discussions of cotton since a number of years ago. I don't think that I have to make an introduction to Ideas. I joined Ideas only some months ago, but for me, Ideas has been linked for years to the cotton work done by the G4, and I'm glad to see to be able to say that Mr. Imboden, who has been a key player in this, is in our table, and he is our executive director in Ideas. The subject of today, from crop to shop, climbing in the cotton textile value chain through regional integration in Africa, we believe that is a very timely subject. We're in Africa. We're talking about trade. We are close to where more than 160 policymakers are making efforts to decide on rules on trade, world rules on trade that will likely have an impact on agriculture, on cotton, on global value chains. We have in the atmosphere this discussion since some years ago. I wouldn't say that it's new that that the fragmentation of production started, but the way in which the levels of fragmentation that we have today in world production is achieved levels that we had never seen before. Most of manufacturing or agriculture production in a number of very elaborated products do not take place in one single country. So these models of competition between domestic and foreign finished goods with a very national character is something that has been losing ground in the last times, which open opportunities for developing countries. Developing countries that were not able to participate in or produce the full finished product from design to the final product, or from collecting the crops to the final product in the markets of developed countries, can now participate in different ways in this chain. And it is very much the aim of many developing countries to be able to go up in the value-added level as to take profit from higher wages and higher benefits of today's global trade. Africa has been making efforts over the years, and integrating into global and regional networks is widely regarded in Africa as essential for achieving transformative growth on a sustainable basis as well. Africa is making important efforts of integration at different levels and in different areas of geography, and this is something that has been linked as well with the more efficient participation in global trade. There are many that want to have global value chains at the African level, and from there to jump into global value chains at the global level. We wanted to have people that have experience in different areas, people from the private sector, as well as people from the public sector and international organizations in our discussion, as to be able to have a wide perspective. And I hope that that wide perspective can be completed with the participation, active participation of you in the part of questions and answers. Let me introduce the participants of today. Mr. Ibrahim Alum will be speaking first. We thank you him very much because His Excellency Ambassador Landru had he was not able to come. He had a last minute commitment. We're working in parallel to the negotiations, so these things happen. Thank you very much for joining us in the table. It was our expectation to have very good people in the audience, and that's how a very good person from the audience jumped into the table. So don't feel free to be part of the discussion when the moment comes. He has been the Director General of Child Cotton Textile, and former DG of Cotton. He has a wide experience, and he was the president of the Cotton Association as well. Then I'd like to introduce Mr. Fred Congongo. He has a wide experience in STEM as well. He has contributed to the creation of two simultaneous processes in Africa, deepening regional integration and strengthening the cotton value chain. He currently works as sector market linkage specialist at the USAID East Africa Trade and Investment Hub. Prior to joining the hub, he helped drive the industrialization, science, technology, and innovation programs at the Common Market for Eastern and Southern Africa. He is a very experienced person as well, with a wide experience in cotton. And then Mr. Betty is a person that has as well a wide perspective. He has a long experience in the manufacturing sector in Kenya. He has been an industrialist himself and an entrepreneur who has numerous responsibilities in business and various business member organizations. And he has been linked to the textiles industry for many years and in different capacities. He has served in the board of export processing zones. And currently, he is the Vice President of International Textile Manufacturers Federation, as well as the Chairman of the African Cotton and Textile Industries Federation. And I have a paper. That Mrs. Diallo gave me a little while ago with her bio that I misplaced somewhere around here. I want to say that she has a long experience, over 15 years of experience working in the International Trade Center. She has worked in the cotton field for a number of years. She is part of a very interesting project that deals not only with global value chains and the textile industry, but also with the participation of women in the textile industry and in the high end of value added, which I believe is very interesting, a wonderful effort that the International Trade Center is doing. She worked for a number of years in the field of human rights prior to joining the International Trade Center. So, well, without taking more time with introductions, Mr. Imboden is going to act as a discussant in our panel. I'd like to invite Mr. Malu to make the first intervention. I remind you that you have 12 minutes, and I will be keeping the time. I may tell you if you're going beyond the limit. You have the floor.
Thank you very much. For me, it was a surprise to come to talk to you because I came to assist to this meeting. But Mr. Mboden asked me to make intervention. Okay, right now, and I will tell you just about my experience. My English is very poor, frankly speaking. And so, first of all, thank you very much, Mr. Mboden. We know you for a long time. You are really the leader to train the African, to help the African cotton producer to introduce the cage of C4 in cotton problems in WTO since 2003. We are working with you, and I take this floor, frankly speaking, to thank you very much for all you did for African cotton producer and the African industry, cotton industry. First of all, I think the cotton for African people, I will particularly talk about Western Central African cotton production and textile. As I was before a general manager of Cotton Chad, and also we have built up with some friends the African Cotton Association. And now I am in charge of textile industry in Chad. First of all, we cannot talk about textile industry without talking about raw cotton first. And Africa have an comparative advantages to produce cotton. And in Western Central African countries, we have 15 million small farmers who get their income from cotton activity, cultivation. And these last years, until 2009, the cotton activity was not profitable anymore for our farmers. It's not profitable because of huge subsidies given by developed countries like United States and European and some other countries to their farmer. And these subsidies granted to their farmer posed to increase the world production of cotton. And this huge production came on the market to reduce, the offer is higher than the demand and the price dropped. For more than 15 years, we have a very low price. All the activities was really difficult, and the situation increased poverty in our side countries in for our farmers. Is that why? Africa, some countries, four countries, Burkina Faso, Mali, Chad, and Benin, introduced this problem in the WTO in 2003 in Cancun. From that, everybody of you hear about these problems that the four countries, the least developing countries, would like in WTO to push to cut these subsidies to allow our farmer to improve their standard way of life. But until now, 15 years we are working, we are fighting on the WTO, no progress. And even this case will be also the big issue this is, during this session here in Nairobi. We hope it will not block the negotiation because all the African countries who produce the cotton, for us to be in the WTO is first of all about cotton for our four countries. And that is well understood. We cannot be associated to any progress in the negotiation without finding a solution for the problem of domestic support and export support made by some developed countries. Telling that, I think common on the problem of the cotton in our sectors, different sectors. First of all, African producers are producing a very fine cotton, very good cotton, because many things was made, first of all, in the research, cotton research, in all the, our countries. The cotton that we are offering in the international market, because 97% of the production in the Western Central African is for export. A very few was going to the textile industry. 2% only of the West African production went to the textile industry in the African countries. The remainder is for export. Is that, you know, when the price in the world market is dropping, our income also dropping for our farmers. And the decision in all our countries was to make, to transform, to consume at least 10% of our production through the domestic textile industry. But the problem is, when you talk about the world price is very low, the consequence of the subsidies made by developed countries is the same in the textile industry. Because first of all, when the developed countries subsidize their farmers, cotton farmers, they are overproduct cotton in the world, making price dropping, and they are also the first exporter of the cotton. Country like China or India or Pakistan buying a subsidized cotton offered by developed countries. And they can be more competitive to transform this cotton into yarn and textile product. In our country, if you have to buy this cotton of the new of price that we have in Africa, this price is a little bit higher than the international, and we cannot compete with country like China or India on the textile industry. That another problem. Also, competition on the price of the cotton, raw cotton, and competition in the textile. And country like China are producing fabrics from subsidized cotton coming from United States, and they are selling their product really at the dumping price. I know, first of all, they have invest for their huge and domestic market. They are making profit, rentabilizing their investment, and they have to tackle the world market in the marginal cost of production. You cannot compete with these countries. But that we cannot let our hands to not fight. That why we are fighting here in WTO, and also pushing how to reduce our cost of production and how to be compete in our domestic market first before going to the international market. The problems that facing the textile industry in Africa, West and Central African countries, is first of all the cost of energy. We know, everybody knows, in these countries, the energy is really very costly, and textile industry using a lot of energy. That's first thing. The second thing, the competition coming from Far East countries, coming mainly from China and India, and they are selling at the dumping price, who came to compete with our domestic and very small textile unities. The third problem for all the Western Central African countries who speak French, they have one currency called CFA franc. The CFA franc is linked to the euro with the fixed parity. And everybody knows that euro is a very strong currency. And so our money is really very strong. It facilitates the importation and not pure exportation. All the product made in the Francophone areas are very expensive to be to compete in the international market. That's another problem for our textile industries. This is the currency. Another factor which is very negative is the size of the market. Each country, small country, we are small countries, 10 million people, 7 million people, and so each country have developed a domestic textile industry. It's very small. The cost of production is still higher. Even sometimes it cannot absorb the fixed cost, kufix moyen, the average fixed cost. And so they cannot compute the dimension of car. Normally we have to create a big textile industry for a regional market that you can reduce your cost to compete sometimes with the imported product. Another real problem also, if you see, I think it's the same even here in Nairobi, is the importing of the second-hand product. In English, I don't know how you call it.
Is the same?
Okay, it's second-hand product. That also came in to compete with the domestic production of textile. If you would like, because really, I think Africa must invest in the textile to compete. I think the future, we cannot let this area to the ASEAN countries or Chinese to come to produce and to export in our country. We have to see, to analyze, to find the way to give more competition to our textile industry, our cotton industry, to compete and to create jobs, to add the value of our raw material, our cotton, and also as a textile, everybody will know, knows. In West Africa, in Europe, in Asia, in even United, in America, the cotton is one of the first steps of the development because using a lot of people working inside, and also to help to make more added value of our raw materials. I think that we are fighting in this, and we hope, first of all, to improve our productivity in the cotton sector, raw cotton first, to increase the productivity in the field, to produce a very good cotton free of any contamination for the spinners, and also to market this cotton by in very good classification of the cotton through HVI. I think some spinners with here, as you know, the first thing is the quality of the cotton that people have to deliver to a spinner in terms of spinability, longer tenacity, elongation, and all the technical aspect of the fiber is very important. Okay, I think we are doing that, and we have also to develop the textile industry in our countries. If you have any question of this aspect, I'm ready to go in the details. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your presentation and for the picture that you present of the challenges of African countries in the cotton production and the explanation you have given to the challenges in particular with regard to the subsidies. Thank you for respecting the time. That was 12 minutes. Very good. May I offer the floor now to Mr. Petty?
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think as we discuss cotton, it's more important for us to discuss the big picture cotton first before we zero in on Africa. And the big picture cotton is simple. Last year's production was about 23 million tons. On average, the world is growing about 25 million tons of cotton. And if you number the players, who are the players of that 25 million? Surely the biggest producer of cotton today is India. India is producing about 5.5 million tons. Their milk consumption is about 4.5 million tons. They're exporting about 1 million tons. China is now number two. It used to be the number one production country of cotton. Now they're at 4.5 million tons, and their consumption is about 6 million tons, so they import about 1.5 million tons of cotton. A lot of it used to come from the US, but they're also sitting on a lot of cotton in stock. They're sitting on 11 million tons, which they bought at a very high price, which led to 10 million spindles being shut down in China, and people are not sure about the quality of that cotton. So if the cotton prices are depressed, it's also to do with what stocks the world is holding. And it's very important to put that in perspective. The third largest player in cotton today is the U.S. Their production has come down from 4.5 million tons to 3.5 million tons. And out of that, they consume about 800,000 kilos, 0.8 million tons, and the rest is all for export. So they are definitely the number one exporter of cotton, although their production has come down, which is almost about 2.5 million tons of cotton which is being exported. Then, of course, the fourth largest player is Pakistan, 2 million tons. I think they consume about 1.5 million tons. They probably have a 500,000-ton surplus. Then, of course, all the smaller players, Australia, Brazil, about 1.5 million tons of each. And I think Africa also comes as a continent around 1.5 million tons. Out of the 1.5 million tons that Africa is producing, 75% of that cotton is exported in raw form. And yes, there is little or no value addition done. And I agree with my colleague panelist, Mr. Maloum, that most of it is sold in raw form. Out of that 1.5 million tons of cotton that Africa produces, 70% is also grown in West Africa. So West Africa is probably the larger player when it comes to a region in cotton. East and Central and Southern Africa production is much lower, but the consumption patterns are almost the same across the continent. And then when you look at the total programs on support and subsidies and blah, 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 the total program is worldwide is about $10 billion. And out of the $10 billion, my statistics tell me last year the United States only gave $450 million support to their agribusiness. And a lot of support was given by other countries as well. And that includes China and India and in different forms. So we have a situation here that we have an industry that is functional with a lot of, sorry, this doesn't seem to be working. I'll use this mic. Thank you. Sorry if you were struggling with that. But we have a situation here where we've got technology competing with conventional crops. And if you look at the rest of the world, the entire world except of Africa, and within Africa, there are only two countries in Africa that are using technology to their advantage when it comes to improved yield and improved production. And those two countries are Burkina Faso and South Africa. They are the only ones who have adopted BT cotton, and their production and yields are much are still to be tested. I believe the Burkina Faso example.
But it only helps towards building some sort of a knowledge base that needs to be further developed for technology. You also see that basically coming back to promote technological.
Okay, we're getting
the issue in
sound from another source, I guess.
So I think I was right? Technology is playing a big role in everything we do today, even in our airspace, as you can see.
I was close to saying, be patient with the questions. I know that you're very interested, but it was something else.
So anyway, so going back to technology, Africa seems to be the only one that is still growing. A bulk of the African produce comes in, I think as high as 90% comes in from conventional cotton. And of course, conventional cotton has is a smallholder program. Its yields are much lower. And when you talk about competition and competitiveness, of course, you know, it's like taking a donkey into a horse race and asking the donkey to win that horse race. It's not going to be easy for that donkey to win a horse race, right? So you've got to have a level playing field. So you're all competing with horses. And then, yes, you'll have somebody who'll be a winner and somebody who'll be a loser. But at least you all had the same machinery, the same tools, the same equipment in the same utility vehicle. So with all that in mind, when you look at the big picture, world prices are determined by demand and supply, and in the demand and supply, prices go up, prices go down. Right now, cotton is trading at around 70 cents a pound, and yes, China is sitting on stocks which they bought at 120 cents a pound, and yes, if they offload those stocks, the 70 cents a pound will not be sustainable. It'll probably go down to 40 cents a pound. And yes, cotton is competing with polyester. And, you know, so it's a very, very complex subject. It's very easy to blame one person and say he is the problem, because that's the easiest solution. But the bigger problem is that cotton also has a competition, and besides competition within on the world price on demand and supply, it's got competition with other fibers. And if you look at the total all fibers demand today, it's 80 million tons. Out of 80 million tons, 50 million tons is polyester. And if cotton is 25 million tons, that means out of the 80 million tons, two fibers are 75 million tons, and then 5 million tons is the wools and the other natural fibers and remi and flax and blah, blah, blah. So we have a pie which is 80 million tons, and we have a pie that is growing. And that pie that's going to grow by 2040, 2050, the estimate is going to grow up by 50%. The world population is going to grow from 7 billion to 9 billion. Consumption of all textiles is going to go up from 80 million tons to 120 million tons. And I don't think there is enough land and acreage available for cotton to grow. So cotton, to me, is going to become a luxury fiber. I don't think it will go on beyond 25, 30 million tons maybe. But we have a landmass that needs to feed this new world. Today's population is 7 billion. In 30 years' time, the population is going to be 9 billion. We've got 2 billion people more on this planet. In the last 50 years, we've only had 2 billion people added on to what was the world population in 1960s. Today we are on 7 billion. But in the next 30 years, our population is going to hit 9 billion. So that means everything is growing faster and faster and faster. But that would mean, how do we clothe our people, or how do we package our people? Because according to me, textiles is packaging material for human beings, in simple words. So how are you going to do that if you don't have enough production? And what is going to happen is, of course, synthetic fibers and polyesters is winning this race, and they're continuing to go. So there is a competition within all fibers as well, where polyester is competing with cotton. And if I give you the world price of polyester today, with the oil prices where they are at $37 a barrel, polyester is at 45 cents a pound. So cotton is also competing with polyester. So there is it's a very complex situation, it's a very complex issue. But the question here is, how can Africa, and because we are here in this meeting, how can Africa benefit from the current realities on the ground? It's good to have an idealistic world, but what is the reality on the ground? And the realistic world is slightly different. To me, that it'll be difficult for Africa to compete, because Africa doesn't have technology in terms of crop production, in terms of legislation that controls genetically modified cash crops or GM cotton. Yes, one country has tried, but two have tried, but the one I'm talking about, Burkina Faso in West Africa, was not so successful. They had their own issues. Maybe it was varieties or type of varieties, but whatever it was, we've got, we're, like I said earlier on, we're competing in a horse race with a donkey, and that's not going to take us too far. So what should we do as a continent? I think we need to start looking at our cotton differently, and we need to start branding our cotton differently, and we need to start selling our cotton differently, and we need to move away from what we all do, unique selling proposition. This is my USP. We need to move from USP to UVP. This is my unique value proposition. So my value proposition on cotton is that I have got sustainable cotton, or I've got traceable cotton, and there are programs right now, and more than 700,000 farmers in Africa who are growing cotton made in Africa with the help of the Kompaki program, DEG. A lot is being done in West Africa. In our own plantations in Uganda, we are doing CMIA, cotton made in Africa. So we need to tag your cotton differently so that it has a different demand. We need to move our cotton into an identity cotton space, so that the world, as the world moves into traceability and sustainability, Africa becomes the forerunner. And all the large corporates in the world are now talking about, we're going to have sustainable and traceable cotton by 2020, whether it's Walmart, Marks & Spencer, Tesco, IKEA, H&M, each and every one of them have got the end date of this game is going to be 2020, and 2020 is down the road. H&M, I think they're already saying it's 2018. So in the next 2-3 years, the entire pie is going to be talking about sustainable, traceable cotton. And I think that, to me, is the greatest opportunity for Africa. And Africa, because of smallholder farmers and because it's not irrigated cotton and the yields are lower, we need to very quickly move up into that space so that we can capture that value and give the customer a new opportunity to buy different, with a different tagline and a story behind the label. So that, to me, is crucial. And I think I'd love to leave this as a an interactive session, because that's what I'm told by the organizers. I would like to stop here, but I'm happy to answer any of your questions. But just to give you a little background, besides being the chairman of the African Cotton and Textile Industries Federation and the vice president of the International Textile Manufacturers Federation, in my own right, where I'm a textile player, we have huge investments in the textile value chain in Kenya. We've got a factory 2 hours down the road from here. We're building a new factory in a new export processing zone, which will be ready in 7 months from now. And we're also in Uganda, and we have a Pan-African vision, and we will be hopefully in 10 years' time across the continent with value chains. And we don't believe in being part of a chain. We believe in the full value chain. Our model is field to fashion, almost very similar to what we're talking about, crop to shop. And we're already doing it in two countries, and we would like to replicate that in the rest of the continent. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Betty. Thank you for a very interesting picture of the different players in the content market today. For the interesting perspective that you put with regard to other subsidizers, I'm bringing this subject again because I think it is important for Africans. But also for the forward-looking situation of the market, that should allow us to calibrate policies and our discussion in what the market may look like in the coming decades. May I now offer the floor to Mr. Kongongo?
Thank you very much. I decided to break the monotony a little bit and use a PowerPoint. I will jump some of the slides because they've already been talked about, but I was asked to talk about the role of regional integration in promoting collaboration within the textile value chain. These statistics have been talked about, so I would like just to jump them a little bit, but just highlight them. And some of the negotiations that's happening now also has been talked about. But my focus is on the opportunities that are provided, especially as far as regional integration are concerned. One of the areas where I also just mentioned is about Africa. How can we take advantage of this? We find that this landmass is a great opportunity for the cotton production, especially if we acquire the technology. We stop using the hoe, because there's a huge part of Africa that can be beneficial for cotton production, but not other crops. And it's an opportunity which we've not taken advantage of very well. And this is why three regional integration communities, COMESA, ECAS, and also UMOA, elaborated regional strategies. This was to align efforts that were happening at national levels, to harmonize them at regional level, to be able to work together, to move together, but also to have the power in negotiations, but also to influence, because we found out that these regional economic communities were also negotiating free trade arrangements. And these free trade arrangements are also affecting the trade, the textile trade within these communities. So with these strategies were now informing the rules of origin when they're doing negotiations, because facts were laid on the table, area of common collaborations were laid on the table. So this has really helped, but apart from that, it has also helped in harmonizing approaches, especially among people who are intervening along those sectors, when it comes to development partners, when it comes to countries. Because apart from just working on those trade liberation, the regional economic community are also working on economic corridors. And these economic corridors are facilitators of trade within those corridors. So these regional strategies informs these economic corridors. And out of them, there are potentials for investors. For example, within these economic communities is a growing population, and the middle classes are growing, and the consumption for fabrics and for textiles are also growing with them. So the regional economic communities highlight this as one of the potential. If you go into those strategies, then the investment-friendly policies and regulations. What this regional strategy has managed to do is to create like a peer review among countries. So they're looking at, Ethiopia is doing this, Tanzania is doing this, or Nigeria is doing this, it's possible for us to do it. What are some of the policies that are happening in facilitating investment in Kenya that has made them to attract all these investments? So through these strategies, these are highlighted and has been able to help accelerate, especially creation of friendly strategies within these countries. And there's also an increase in the number of factories that are coming up which are socially compliant, like the one of Jazz talking about, like his factory, socially compliant. So these are value propositions that are highlighted in some of these strategies. And then the availability of this raw material, we find that almost 75% of it is being exported. So these opportunities are highlighted in these strategies so that whoever, especially as country level, as a regional level, because you can invest in one country, but you're able to accumulate with other countries. So you'll be able to access this raw material regionally. And then availability of trainable workforce is also highlighted in these strategies. This workforce, especially for this value chain, is a very important factor, especially in cost of production. Yeah, and because with cost going up in other regions, this will be a force, and all this are attracted, and then this will be able to help integrate investment across the region. So how, after doing this, how can Africa climb, especially along the value chain, not remain just at growing cotton level, just grow cotton, and then how can you climb around the value chain? We can start at the cotton level as a driver of rural industrialization, yeah. We try to package, especially certain regions where there's enough water and there's enough potential, and then there's a correct connectivity. You can use cotton as a rural industrialization to build, to decongest towns, to decongest most of the cities, using cotton as a driver of rural industrialization. And then there's a great potential in the region for vertical integration, especially from fiber to fashion. When I talk about fiber, I don't want to limit this just to cotton. Because when it comes to regional consumption of fabrics, our consumption is blended within the region for interregional trade. So we need to position cotton as the blend of choice, because polyester is already leading. So because you can blend it with viscose, you can blend it with other things, but then cotton can be a blend of choice, because for our regional consumption, we consume very little of 100% cotton. So that's provide an opportunity. Then we don't need to look at each country as a competitor, but they can collaborate to compete in global value chains. So that countries, especially using interregional platforms, they look at each other as collaborators. My competitor is not, let's say, Tanzania, or is not Nigeria, or is not, but they can collaborate within that space to enter global value chain. And because of the assembling nature of manufacturing in the world, there's room for the small and the big, in that you can get some parts from this and get from this other guy, and then you finish as a small country, and then you take it to the market. And then we need also to set local and regional platform for coordination, because all these efforts are happening, and some of them we don't realize. So sometimes we talk about problems a lot, because the good things that are happening on the ground are not coordinated. So the regional strategies are providing opportunity to coordinate these efforts so that we can use them to influence, especially policy changes in other countries that are lagging behind, so that we can move together and upgrade. And then the greatest missing link is the strengthening academia, public and private sector, so that they can move together, especially in terms of the area of research and the area of forecasting, because the academia will do the scenarios for countries. They can do the scenario with scenario A, scenario B, and then the public sectors develop policies based on those scenarios. Then the private sector now get enabling environment now to run. So some people say that private sector is the engine of economic development. Sometimes when I think about this, I realize that they are the wheels, not the engine. Because, for example, look at Burundi now. Government messed up. That's the engine. Yeah. Because of some policies, everything stops. I think that, especially for developing countries, the role of the public sector in creating an enabling environment drives other sectors. If they mess up with the policies, everyone is on a standstill. If government procurement, for example, changes to favor local content, you find that this can lead to the growth of the textile industry if they enforce this, because that's the only policy space that is available for governments now to encourage the development of textiles. I say that for our local textile consumption, we want to make a rule that this number of percentage is local content. You find that you can thrive. Maybe it's whether it's fabric, whether it's clothing. Then we have strategic regional incentive, meaning mutual facilities, especially if countries have good facilities for research, they can share these. So this is what the regional interaction is encouraging. You can share, because for cotton, you have to continuously produce varieties. If you use one variety for a long time, and that's the problem we have in this region, then the yields continue to go down like this. And for you to be able to develop these varieties, you need researchers. And I'm told the average age for researchers now is like 50. It means that there are so many, there's a huge gap, because we don't have very many people entering into the cotton research. So we can share these competencies. But for us to move up the global value chain, we need to acquire technology behind the product. And we need to build capability to acquire it, because it cannot just come. And then we need to carry out capability mapping to know where we are now, so that where we are running on a shortfall, we can be able to import for a short while to upscale our capability to acquire the technology, so that we cannot remain at the commodity stage. But for this to happen, we need to think long term, like 10 years beyond the election cycles. So we need to have policies that outlive the government, that are permanent, so that we can implement them, whether this government come in, this government go out, we can be able to implement them. And then I don't want to pass this, because most people have talked about the infrastructure, the policy. I want to pass them and then dwell on this. But the future especially is in our hands, because policies have been reformed, the relevant partners have been mobilized, and then, let me come here. However, at the regional integration level, this is where I would like to say, the current focus is more of tariff reduction. So people look at this as zero-sum game. Then if I reduce my tariffs, I'd lose. But if we change our end objective, that we want to use tariff to industrialize, that we want to use tariff to achieve economies of scale, that we want to use tariff reduction for collaboration to compete in the global market, we find that we can be able to accelerate regional integration. And regional integration will be very, very beneficial for the cotton textile, because we need it. If you look at the amount of import that's coming within this region, whether second-hand clothes or whether new clothes, it means consumption is going up. Consumption per capita is going up. But we don't have the economies of scale to be able to compete, because fabric can come from outside the region and still outsell us. But if you have this market, big market, and factories producing and accumulating within these countries in terms of getting raw materials, in terms of semi-process, we have intra-industry trade. If you use regional integration to encourage intra-industry trade, then regional integration will not be a zero-sum game. That we sign trade protocol like this, then we bring NTB from the back pocket, and then we block it. But when people view it as an opportunity to develop competency. I'll close by saying that in Africa, regional integration can be a prerequisite for textile industry growth. In the three regional cotton strategy, mutualization of solution is taken as a means to strengthen the cotton value chain. This will help the value chain become stronger, and in terms of negotiation, Mr. Malum, if all the regional economic community go as one, we might have bigger impact and we might have more power. And this more power will make means that somebody can sit down with us and we negotiate. For the three regional integration strategies, you can contact either contacts of the regional economic community we worked with are all there. I thank you.
Presentation, and I'd like to highlight and take one of your last sentences. You said that the future is in our hands, and you refer to policy. While Mr. Betty at some point in time indicated the important steps that have been taken or are being taken in Africa from the side of the industry. You mentioned a number of components. You mentioned also academy and important relationship with different players. I'd like to come to that later, but I want to like to highlight the importance of that relationship. Thank you very much for very interesting presentation from the panelists. I would like now offer the floor to Mr. Mbonin, who is the discussant. Mr. Mbonin, you have the floor. Oh, excuse me. Oh, I'm really sorry. And I have to say something else. I made a mistake at the very beginning. This is the second. The first one I made it may have passed in unnoticed. And that is, I'd like to say that Mrs. Arantxa Gonzalez could not make it for a similar reason. She had compelling reasons that did not allow her to come. And thank you very much for coming in your presentation of the International Trade Center. As I said before, there are a number of parallel meetings taking place, and it's only understandable that this kind of situations happen. You have the floor.
Yes. So thank you very much. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to contribute to this panel. As you know, the International Trade Center is a joint UN and WTO technical cooperation agency. And our mandate is really to promote trade and to develop export in least developed countries, such as the C4. And I have to say that ITC has been working in the cotton sector for almost 30 years. But since 2005, we have registered a number of tangible results in this area, working closely with the regional economic communities, such as the West African Economic and Monetary Union, UEMOA, as well as the Central Economic and Monetary Union, the CEMAC. What we have been doing is really to show that in cotton, first, everything is good, and also trying to add, to show that in Africa and in the C4, it's possible to add to promote local value addition, means that to help the cotton producers and the cotton exporters, in fact, to supply not only the international market, but to supply also the regional market, which is also an important market to be considered. So if you allow me, please, I would like to remind our work in the cotton sector, what we have been doing at the regional level as well as at the national level using a recent project that we are currently running in Burkina Faso. So the International Trade Center, we have been supporting UEMOA and CEMAC in developing regional strategies in order to provide the policy makers with a vision, but not only, in order for them to know what are their priorities when they want to, what are their priorities in terms of sector development, and which market they should identified in order also to diversify a little bit, the export. So we have developed these regional sector strategies using our the value chain approach. We have also worked at the meso level with trade support institutions, especially cotton associations in West Africa, in order for them to better support their members and to provide the right support to the smallholder farmers, but also to the exporters that want to reach the Asian market, for instance. And we have been also building the capacities of the exporters in terms of producers and exporters, in terms of quality, in terms of packaging. And we have conducted a number of study tours in Asia to better show them what are, in fact, the needs of the Asian market. So we have conducted a number of missions in Indonesia, in China, in Bangladesh, and also to position the African cotton and the C4 cotton. Why? Because they did not have a very good image. So it was very important for ITC to help those countries, those actors, to better position their product so that they can get, they can get some contract with the Asian buyers. And we have been also promoting South-South cooperation in the context of, in the cotton sector, means that we have been able to promote transfer of technology and transfer of know-how from Asia to the C4 country. Now, coming back to what we are currently doing in Burkina Faso, as you know, in the cotton sector, you have said that I'm an expert. I'm not really an expert, but I'm managing most of the projects that are implemented in the West African portfolio. Most of the producers, they are men. They are not women. So what we are trying to do, because as you know, in ITC, we have a very well-known program on women in trade, but we have another program which is about empowering local communities in order to help them access to the international market. So what we have done in Burkina Faso was really to support the women weavers so that they can design new product to be sold at the international market with designer, well-known designers such as Vivienne Westwood in the UK, but also with Stella Jean, which is also a well-known model, but also designer from IT. So by doing that, we are helping those women weavers to add value to the product that they are selling, to get higher income, and of course, to be able to improve their living standards. So what else can I add at this stage? I can also say that I think some of you were talking about the global value chains. Global value chains, it's not only about the international market. It's also about the domestic market. It's also about the regional market. So I'm wearing this necklace. This is coming from, the design has been made by an Ivorian designer, but the textile is coming from Burkina Faso, and the assembly, you say in English, it has been done in Mali. So what I want to say is that today there is also a big market in Africa and in West Africa. There is an emerging middle class, and more and more, and even here in Kenya, we have seen that we were having our Women International in our Women International Business event last Monday, and most of the Kenyan women that were in the room were wearing African textile, wearing African handicraft necklaces. So I think that it's good to show also that we, African, we can buy African product that has been made locally, with the support of institutions such as the International Trade Center, but not only. So this is the first market for the cotton producers and the cotton processors. They can first look at the domestic and the regional market. Then, of course, when they will improve the quality of their product, they can also go for the international market. So this is what I wanted to say at this stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Diallo. And thank you for introducing the word that international organizations, and in particular, in this case, the wonderful work that the International Trade Center does in helping in the ground the industries in the markets. May I now invite Mr. Ibonim?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I am supposed to be the discussant. It's rather difficult because we had a very big and very interesting outline of the different issues, and I will certainly not try to pretend that I can actually make a conclusion out of that. I was just trying to put down a few elements which I think are important that they came out from the discussion. Because what we really want to do here is to see what are the needs of the private sector, those who really do work on the job, and what are we doing over there, you know, in the negotiations. What is the relationship because with those discussions and what is happening in the field? Because as long as we cannot show that all this fuss over there is of any use to people who are working and are trying to do the development, we will have failed. And I think one of the problems we have in these negotiations is nobody believes anymore that it matters to them of what is happening. And I think that is very, very dangerous, and that's what we are trying to do. When I looked at the problems or the issues that were mentioned, I think there are really positive and negative elements in this possibility. First of all, you know, when we started about 13 years ago with the C4, this issue on subsidies in cotton and so on, many people said, what are you talking about? You know, you are not going to develop a country through agriculture and raw materials, which is true. The problem is there is also no country who has developed without developing the agriculture. And I was very glad to hear today to see the link not only with the cotton prices but also on the textile sector of the subsidies. So these subsidies remain a major issue. There is no question, and it affects not only the cotton growers but also the possibilities of the textile industry in Africa, which is practically non-existent at this moment, partly because of the liberalization that has taken place and has allowed other more efficient producers to cut down the little production that existed in Africa. I'm also happy that actually Mr. Bedi has a little corrected what my friend Malum said in terms of the subsidies. The situation has changed since 2003. Today, the subsidy issue is much more diversified. You know, in 2003, it was the US and the EU which were the problem. Today, the bigger subsidizers are actually China, India, etc. And I think also the mentioning of the importance of the huge stocks that China has, and which it actually could manipulate completely the international cotton price, and that we need some disciplines on that, I think is an important new element that we have to take into consideration. And I think this shows also something else in the negotiations. You know, they're making a big fuss about whether we should have new issues or old issues or whatever. The world is changing. You know, the new issues are the old issues. You know, we have to adapt the issues to the issues that are faced by the people who are working in the field. And I think that is the importance that we do. Now, the second element that I was trying to figure out is really, in a lot of ways, I think there was a general agreement that you need regional integration to help you to compete in the whole world. And I think it was a big effort was made to show that the national markets are too small to have economies of scale, and that you need to have a regional strategy. And I think, as ITC has said, the work that was done with ATC's help to find a vision to see how do we integrate and so on is a very important element. You need a vision, a strategy for the development at the regional level, and you need to be having a critical mass in terms of the market. There was a lot of talk about the need of investment and technology to be at a fair level of competitive things. Well, you know, technology you get through investment. And investment you get through markets. And if you cut down your markets, you know, by borders, you will not get the investments. So I think it is very important that when you make regional integration, that you know that you're not cut off, if you want, the region from the rest of the world, because you will not develop into a competitive sector. I'm not saying that you shouldn't have tariffs on the borders, you know, of the region. Clearly you should. And they might be even relatively high at the beginning. But the private sector should know
that if they get a protection, it's a temporary one, you know, that gives them time to build up their comparative advantage, but that it will reduce so that they have to become competitive. Because what we don't want is to create, to replace the government monopolies that we had by private monopolies, because monopolies are bad. Has nothing to do with government or private sector. We need competition in the markets if we want to become things. Therefore, you know, when I was looking at the things, what you really need in a lot of ways, and I think a lot of discussions there is, for a latecomer on the market, it's very difficult to be competitive for the reasons that Malum mentioned, which are real obstacles to become competitive. You need to cluster your competitors because, you know, it was mentioned by Fred, you know, that one of the big advantages of Africa was that you have a young population that you can train and you can use for textile. That's very true. But if he is an investor in Africa and he is starting a new factory and he trains all the people, it's a high cost for him. And as soon as he has made some profits, you know, he is going to say, wait a minute, I can do that too. And he's going to hire away, you know, the guys that he has trained. And he has not caused the cost of the training of those people. He will have a problem. He will have a problem. And he will have a benefit. So you have to look at this situation and cluster the things so that we can have. So what you can do to cluster or to help the cluster? You know, you were talking, Fred, about having a local content requirements. I don't think, quite frankly said, personally, that this is a good thing. Because it actually will make higher the cost of your inputs compared to what they would be if you didn't have the local. And it doesn't help you to be competitive. But why not define with the private sector what are external costs? If, for instance, he is training the people and they run off to the competition afterwards, to do that together with the private sector to make sure that they're actually the climate or the factors of production, whether they are labor or whatever, are at the level that you need. That is a clustering policy that I think has much more potential benefits than trying to oblige the private sector to sort the way you do. The one other point I wanted to say about regional integration is we are all talking about we having now one market like in ECOWAS because we have gotten rid of the tariffs. But the tariffs are not the problem today in the international in the regional integration. It's the difficulty of and the high cost of moving products from one country to the other. We got to address this issue, and that's what you have to address. You know, if it's impossible to get, you know, the cotton from let's say Chad to the production process in Nigeria or whatever it is, at a relatively high cost, you know, in Nigeria the textile factories will not use the cotton from Chad, and if you force him to use the cotton of Chad, you know, he will not be competitive on the world market. So we got to look, and you know all that the highest costs of transactions in the world are in Africa. So this is a big priority, and I think Africa and you, the private sector, would be well advised to put pressure on your governments to move ahead with the measures that are things, especially as there is plenty of donor money available to help you to improve those things. The last point I wanted to make is the issue of branding. I think that's a very important point because I do believe that you have a comparative advantage in branding for the reasons that Mr. Betty mentioned. You know, you're having small producers who produce in an ecological way. Not because they want to do it, because they don't have the resources to put all the bad things that you do normally in the production process into their land. So you do have a good product, and that is actually sustainable. But as long as you export your cotton, you know, and it goes to China for being transformed, and it comes back to here, it's no more an ecological problem. You know, I had a T-shirt which was supposedly ecological from Mali, but it was produced in China. So it goes, it is ecological cotton, and then it goes to China and it's produced I don't know how, and it comes back here. I mean, it cannot be ecological. So you got to look at the value chains when you want to get that brand name. And I do believe, just like you, that this is a big opportunity for your countries. But then at the same time, I hear that you want to produce for your regional market. That's not the branded product. You know, that's the cheap product, because your population has still a low income level and they want cheap thing. You know, we were talking about the huge demand that is there, and that will be in the region because of the growth of the population. I think it's true. But for those people, they need cheap cotton. So you have to split the market. You have to know what you want, and you have to target your markets according to what the people want. That's really the thing. So I think what I would like you to do is that you are asking your governments to be responsible towards you. You know your problems, you are working in the sectors, and you should insist that you are getting the services that you do need to be able to be competitive. Don't let governments to define that. It's your job, because you know it in the field of what to do it. And it's your job then to force your governments, you know, to go so that you can be competitive both regionally and internationally. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Imbonen, for a very enlightening set of reflections. Let me ask a question to all the speakers before giving the floor to the audience. I'd like to come back to a point that I mentioned early in my introduction, and that is, what is the relationship between what we are discussing here, global value chains, and the ways in which African countries can take profit of global value chains, this way in which trade functions today. Trade and production. What is the relationship? What do we expect from the policymakers, 160 policymakers meeting there to deliver, in particular with regard to global value chains, for them, for African countries to be able to take full profit of them? And let me ask you about some elements. Are these elements that I'm going to mention related to it? Goods liberalization, tariffs, but services liberalization, is it linked to that? Trade facilitation, investment policy? And if you can give each of you a piece of advice to those men and women taking those decisions for the rest of us, what would you suggest? What would be the element that you would add, either to be decided here or in the agenda they may decide for the coming years, for global value chains to work for African countries? Who wants to start?
Thank you very much. I think I'll go to your specific questions in a minute, but I just want to set the tone right slightly differently. If we look at the World Trade Organization, set up in 1995, we're now 20 years old, it replaced GATT, and it had an agenda, and it had, I think, the core vision on that day by the architects of WTO was that we want to have a world free of quotas, a world free of tariff, and free trade in goods and services. That's all the essence. And if we do a stock take 20 years on, 2015, what have we achieved? I think the Doha development agenda that was being discussed did not go through. Cancun had its own problems. To me, WTO is going to become an organization that will be only used for trade disputes and facilitation and things like that, because time is moving on, and this multilateral trading system has moved on. It's becoming more like a bilateral trading system. And if you look at what is happening in the world, and if you look at right now the U.S. negotiating TPP with 12 Asian countries, negotiating with Europe TTIP, and 60% of the world's trade will be demanded by FTAs. So we're actually creating now a new World Trade Order, a new WTO. It's no longer World Trade Organization, but it's moving to a new World Trade Order. And that order is changing so rapidly, and it's becoming bilateral as opposed to multilateral. So there's a fundamental flaw in what was supposed to be and what is becoming. And so what will World Trade Organization become? I think a dispute settlement organization. Then we move forward to subsidies and supports and serious and material damage to global supply chains and global value chains. In serious and material damage, you have to apply to WTO in the current form. You've got to write to them, and you've got to talk about the injury that your industry and your value chain has suffered. And against that injury that you have, you can then have countervailing taxes and duties and blah, blah, blah. And then we look at Africa. Africa has no capacity to support or to subsidize its industries and value chains, and because of that, Africa is the only one playing by the book. Playing by the book, and Africa is only holier than thou. They don't have the capacity to support and subsidize, and in the process, they are the only ones playing by the rules of WTO. And if they try to do that, they're told very quickly to slow down to be specific about what they're trying to do. I've got 1 minute, so I'll go straight back to your questions. What should be the advice we give to the people across the road on the other side in terms of tariff, service, trade facilitation, and investment policy? At the end of the day, I don't think we need to reinvent the wheel. If we want to industrialize, we have to start with a basic industry. The entire world, from the UK in 1900 to Asia, China included, started with one basic industry, and that was the textile apparel industry. And if Africa needs to compete effectively, it needs to start with that same basic industry. We do not need to reinvent the wheel. And so the answer to me is very simple. How do we create that level playing field? And that level playing field where Africa can compete. Africa has a problem to compete with second-hand clothes. You hardly see second-hand clothes in Europe or U.S., but you see second-hand clothes in Africa. You hardly see second-hand clothes in India because it's a taboo. I don't want to wear, like President Museveni says, a dead man's clothes. And Africa has problems with overruns and seconds. We don't have the mechanism and the policing. Our customs and border controls are porous. We don't have the police mechanisms. Customs do get compromised sometimes. There's uncustomed goods on their way, overruns. So there's a lot of dumping that happens. So what cannot be sold in Europe or US because it's time-bound and season-bound and winter-summer-bound eventually ends up coming here at dumping prices. And with dumping, we have serious and material damage to our industry. So how do you compete with that unlevel playing field? And if you look at our tariff book right now, and especially I can talk about East Africa, we have a three-band structure. How many tariff books in the world only have three bands? You know, zero for raw materials, 10 for intermediate goods, and 25% for finished goods. I was looking at the U.S. tariff book, and I was looking at the U.S. Under the TPP negotiations on what will be given for immediate accession to duty-free into the U.S., and they're like 57 line items. And every line item, depending on the U.S. industry, is actually protected, or if it's in short supply, not protected. And we just don't have those mechanisms and those capacities. So fundamentally, we're trying to compete with information and information flow, and we're trying to compete with porous borders. So the one advice I would like to give is, let's level the playing field, and let's look at each other. And you know, if we really have to compete, and I know Africa, we compete at a very different level when it comes to marathons, and whether you're American or European or Asian, you just can't run as fast as we can, that we have the capacity. Thank you.
Thank you. 2 minutes, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think one of the things that I think for the negotiations there should be, I think second-hand clothes should not be traded, should not be among the traded goods, because right now it has HS code, so it's traded. I think it should never be traded. It should be removed from traded goods. But the key thing is the need to enhance access to technology, because technology is the ladder. It's the ladder that you climb. And what has happened is IP is good, but IP has been used like kicking the ladder, so that the cost of acquiring technology has become very, very expensive because of IP protection. But if you look at the way countries have developed, technologies is what led to transformation of economies. Yeah. Even if you want to modernize agriculture, I want to do. So one of the key areas that each needs to be, they should make it very easy for African to access, especially the latest technologies that are still highly protected. The same way they are doing with the drugs, where they have allowed India to produce generics so that they can have access. This also should be allowed, especially the latest technology that can help Africa competitiveness, so that they can access this latest technology when it comes to spinning, when it comes to the very latest technology. So we can leapfrog, because we are latecomers. The only advantage of latecomers is to leapfrog. But if you follow the steps, you'll never catch up. So the only way latecomers can really catch up is to leapfrog, jump all these shuttle looms and all these, and jump to the latest. And the reason why we cannot jump to the latest is the cost. And the main reason for that cost is the IP protection. That makes it, it's like you've thrown the ladder. I've gone up there now, find your own ladder. So that needs to be negotiated so that it can be affordable for Captory to upgrade. And this technology can help the countries to at least come to a level where they can compete, because if we follow the linear process, we will not catch up. We have to leapfrog the same way we leapfrogged in the IT sector. We leapfrog from landline, we jumped all the way to the latest, which is the mobile phone, because it was made accessible and it became a commodity, so everybody could access it. This is key message I think we need to pass there. And the last one is when it comes to also the investment policy, I think development countries need to be given space to also use some of the policy instruments, especially procurement policy instruments, to allow their companies to compete. I insist in this, because if you look at the history of industrialization, even starting from Britain, when you enter into a new area, you need space to develop that sector, and this need to be taken into consideration. Even right now, even the developed countries, like when it comes to the manufacturing, when it comes to even the aerospace, they're still protecting it. They are not opening it for protection, because that's a developing area. So I think developing countries need that space. They cannot be put on the same table, let's say, with China, or put the same table with India, and we're still even developing capabilities. We have not even reached the technology acquisition. We are developing capabilities to acquire this. So this is also key message that need to go there.
Thank you. Nicholas.
Thank you. I would like to react to some of those things, because I think they're very important. I mean, Mr. Bedia has said, I think rather convincingly, unfortunately, that W2 has been a failure and that it is becoming a dispute settlement body. I'm even more pessimistic than him in the sense that I don't think it will function as a dispute settlement body if it doesn't make the rules. Because the reason that he has mentioned is that WTO is too slow. The world is moving ahead, and you're not adapting your rules. I fully agree. But your governments are exactly saying the contrary. They say don't touch anything new until we have solved all the problems. So I think there is some...
It's a digital world and analog world.
No, but I think it is your job to tell your governments, listen, we should show the flexibility to adapt, not to have newer subjects, but to adapt the WTO rules to the new givens. And especially when I see on the topics that are high on your links, that's getting technology, you know, having investments, anti-dumping measures, etc. I think that is all elements that are should be on the points of discussion. But it's mostly African governments and others, you're not alone, who are refusing to enter into that field. This is one of the points that I wanted to make. And the second one I wanted to make, which is an important one, Mr. Betty said, well, we are the only ones who are following the rules, you know, and we cannot use the countervailing duties because we don't have the capacity to do it. I'm not 100% sure that's the full truth. I don't think Africa follows the rules as much as they pretend. I think the nice thing about Africa is that nobody really looks whether you follow the rules. You know, nobody is attacking you. But, you know, I looked into the cotton issue and, you know, quite frankly said, and I don't want that it goes out of this room, you were subsidizing your cotton quite a bit too. So I think we are all in the bed, they think. Second point I wanted to make, you have to know to play the game. There are many more flexibilities in WTO than you are using. You know, there are a lot of things you can do legally in WTO if you know how to do. Do you think, I was the agricultural negotiator for Switzerland when we had the Uruguay round, it meant a revolution in our country. We spent about most of our time to see how we could twist, you know, so that we would be able to survive. That's also you got to learn, you know, and there is no reason. If you have an issue of subsidies that is real, that you are not following the procedures of WTO and you put countervailing duties in it. Because, by the way, if anybody attacks you, by the time you will be condemned because you haven't followed the procedures, you won't need these duties anymore. So, you know, I think there are more flexibility. That brings me to the third point about the flexibilities that you need. Africa needs space to develop and to have investment. I fully agree with that. But what I don't agree is that this space doesn't exist. This space does exist. You can support your industry to do clustering, to take advantage of certain services. You can give infrastructure, you can give information, as long as you don't do it for one company or for one industrial services. This has allowed subsidies, and nobody in the world will attack you. I think we need space, but we need space to do the right thing, not space to do the wrong thing. And I think that's what is the art of the WTO, to figure out which is the space which we need and which is useful and which one we shouldn't give.
I just make a comment on what you said. 50 years ago, Africa's share of global trade was 4%. Today's Africa's share of global trade is 2%. It's not that our share has shrunk by 50%. The rest of the world has grown much more. So if Africa as a continent is 2% of world trade today, I agree with you totally. We are under the radar. We can do anything we want. Nobody will even notice any market distortion because at 2% you are insignificant. You have no status, no locus standing.
So we agree.
Thank you. Thank you.
Just to say that also we are supporting the work that is currently being done on trade facilitation. Why? If I take quickly the example of UMOA, where there is a free movement of person, free movement of goods and services in theory, but in fact, it's not the case. When you want to export something from Burkina Faso to Mali, you still face some constraint. We know that because we are not working on the cotton sector, we are working on mangoes, we are supporting the cashew nut producers in West Africa, and we know that it's very difficult for them to overcome some of the constraints that they are facing when they want to export one product to another one. So this is why we are also at the moment supporting a number of initiatives aiming at facilitating trade among the West African countries, but not only. So this is what I wanted to mention.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you. And thank you for very, very important last point. Global value chains, offers opportunities for many other products. We're using cotton as it is very important to Africa, but we wanted to help this to launch a further discussion in the future with regard to global value chains in other areas of agriculture, but also in industrial goods, because we believe that Africa has the potential, the intelligence to participate in industrial. I invite now the public. We don't have much time, but I'd like to invite for questions. We don't have. I'm having an indication from the organizers
I have a mic. I ask for. Yes, yes.
Okay.
I ask for the floor. My name is Wilfried Yamiogo from Burkina Faso.
Welcome.
Yes, I don't speak. I'm Francophone. But I will try to explain myself in English. Thanks for IDEAS giving us this opportunity to discuss about this critical topic. Thanks to all speakers for their presentation and comments. I would like to thank ITC for talking about the good job made in Burkina Faso. I just want to make one comment about the subject. Apart to fight against subsidies, African countries have to make big effort to ensure the competitiveness of his cotton chain value. The real issue, I thought, is to transform cotton locally. You speak about that. Malum, my brother, Fred, my brother, and Nicola to speak about this issue. We have to build policy in order to transform locally our cotton. If we get that, we go that way, we will disconnect with the fluctuate world cotton price. We will have foreign money, and we also create many employees for our brothers, our sons in Africa. I have to write and read. I don't speak English as well as you. Yes, but it's important to know that our government have to encourage technical training in order to put in the employment market some qualified employers. The existence of qualified employees is important for the private sector. We want to create textile industry. Just what is that I want to do? Thanks.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank everyone. I'd like to...
Can I just quickly say the Blue Number Initiative, which provides for traceability in agricultural value chains, farmers are provided with a winning ID to register through GS1, and the agricultural value chain can be traceable. It's launched between the United Nations, ITC,
UNITC.
And GS1.
Thank you very much. The document is here for everyone in the room for distribution. Anyone can come and take it at the end of the meeting. I'd like to thank everyone. I don't want to make a wrap up because there are different views. I just want to make one point. Very different elements were raised. I think that all of them make part of the discussion of global value chains and the opportunities. One good news that I'd like to share with you, that is whether the 160 plus policymakers come with policies or decisions that have a direct impact or not today or tomorrow, governments always have the opportunity to take autonomous decision. you can take decisions about your own services. Somebody mentioned energy. You don't need a decision there to take decisions on energy. And this applies to logistics. This applies to many other areas. This applies to your ratification of trade facilitation agreement. There are many areas that can be decided alone by members. And you have in your hands the sort of integration in your region that you are trying to achieve. Thank you very much. Feel free to come to the participants and ask any questions that you couldn't ask. Thank you. And thank you for organizers.